This is Abdul Khader from Karnataka Polytechnic, Mangalore, welcoming you to the next class on professional ethics and Indian Constitution. Currently, we are discussing the last unit, that is Unit 6. This is comparatively a longer unit. In the first class, we discussed the basic structure of our Constitution, the salient features of our Constitution, and the preamble to our Constitution. In the second class, we discussed the fundamental rights, and we also discussed the fundamental duties and the directive principles. In the third class, we concentrated on the parliamentary system. We discussed the role and function of the parliament with respect to enacting the laws. The next class, there's a fourth class, we discussed the various aspects related to the union executive, that is the central government. And the fifth, that is the previous class, we discussed the role of judiciary as per our constitution. This is going to be the sixth and the last class of this unit. Here, we are going to discuss the state executive. As we already seen, we are in a quasi-federal system where the powers are distributed between the central government and the state government. That means the central government has certain authority vested with it, and the state government also has got certain authority vested with it. So we'll be discussing the role of the state government in our today's class, that is with respect to our federal system. What are the roles and functions of the state government as per our constitution? That's what we are going to discuss in our today's class. Let's have a quick look at the specific content we'll cover in today's class. We'll start our discussion with the state legislature. This state legislature consists of both Vidhan Sabha and Vidhan Parishad. We'll be looking into the composition and the functions of Vidhan Sabha and Vidhan Parishad. Then we'll move on to discuss the state executive consisting of the governor of the state at the top, the functions and powers vested with the governor. Then we'll go on to discuss the role of the chief minister and also the council of ministers. Then we'll move to the next level, that is the local self, the government. Our constitution envisages the decentralization of power down to the grassroots. So we'll be discussing the roles of Gram Sabha, Gram Panchayat, Taluk Panchayat, Zilla Panchayat, etc. And after that, there are equivalent bodies at the urban level. We'll be discussing the role of the urban local bodies, the municipality, corporations, and the BBMP, which we have in Bangalore. In addition, we'll also be discussing the role, powers, and functions of important constitutional bodies. One of the most important constitutional body is the Election Commission. The foundation of our democracy depends on how fair the elections are. So the Election Commission has got a very, very important role in a democracy. We'll be discussing about Election Commission, and we'll also be discussing the role of Public Service Commission with respect to the appointment related the matters. As usual, in the end, we'll have an interactive quiz based on the contents we are going to discuss in today's class. Let's start with the state government. We'll start with the state legislature. That is, the state legislature consists of the governor and then the legislative assembly and legislative council. One is known as Vidhan Sabha, other one is known as Vidhan Parishad. A state can have what we call unicameral or bicameral legislature. What we mean by unicameral is only one, the legislative body. Bicameral means two legislative bodies. That is, if it is a unicameral bodies, only legislative assembly will be there, legislative council will not be there. That is, in a unicameral legislature, it is only Vidhana Sabha, Vidhana Parishad will not be there. In a bicameral legislature, as we have in our state, we have both the legislative assembly and legislative legislature. What we have today in our state, that's about unicameral and bicameral. Our constitution provides both. We can have a unicameral legislature or we can have a bicameral legislature. If you see all the states in our country, there are only 7 states which have bicameral legislature: Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Jammu and Kashmir, Uttar Pradesh, Telangana, Bihar and Maharashtra are the states which have bicameral legislature. All the remaining states have got unicameral legislature. Let's come to our legislative assembly, that is Vidhana Sabha. The Vidhana Sabha will have the elected members, and these elected members are known as MLAs, member of legislative assemblies. They are directly elected by the people through a universal adult franchise. That is, anybody above the age of 18 years can vote in an election, and the members directly elect the MLAs. That is, these MLAs are directly elected by the people. For contesting for the post of MLA, there are certain conditions. One condition is that the contestant should have attained an age of 25 years. That means people having an age less than 25 years cannot contest for the legislative assembly. In addition, one more condition is that he should not hold an office of profit. He cannot be an employee of an organization drawing the benefit for contesting the election. That means he should not hold any office of profit at the time of contesting the election. There are different number of MLAs in different states, but as per our constitution, the number of MLAs should not exceed the 600. That means that is the limit for the MLAs. The different states have got different number of MLAs. For example, Uttar Pradesh is the biggest state. It has got 403 MLAs. Next comes West Bengal. It has got 294 MLAs. Next is Maharashtra, 288 MLAs. And ours is a comparatively smaller state. We have got 224 MLAs. Recently concluded Gujarat election, we have noticed that there were 182 MLAs. Kerala is still smaller, 140 MLAs. Goa has got only 40 MLAs. Sikkim has got 32 MLAs. That is, the number of MLAs vary from state to state. So this number is determined by the population of the state. If the state has got higher population, there will be more number of the MLAs. The term of the MLAs is 5 years. Once a person is elected an MLA, he holds that position for 5 years unless the assembly is dissolved earlier. Coming to the presiding officer of the legislative assembly, that is Vidhana Sabha, the speaker is the presiding officer of the Vidhana Sabha. Speaker is directly elected by the MLAs. That means the election is held in the assembly for electing the speaker of the assembly. And he has got a role similar to the one we discussed about the speaker of the Lok Sabha. the similar, the parallel duties he performs at the state level, there is going to be another person, a deputy speaker, who is also elected by the MLAs. He conducts the sessions in the absence of the speaker. Coming to the powers and functions of the Legislative Assembly, the number one function of the Vidhan Sabha is the legislative function. That means it has got power to make laws on the state subjects. We have seen there is going to be a union list, a state list, and a concurrent list. With respect to the state list and concurrent list, the state legislative have got power to make laws. This includes the police, the health, the local governance, are some of the issues in the state list, where state can exclusively make the laws. The assembly can pass a bill and it sends it to the governor. And after governor signs, the bill becomes a law. That means every bill has to be signed by the governor to make it into a law. But governor can sign the bill, or in some exceptional or rare cases, the governor can even reserve the bill for the consideration of the president. That means governor can send the bill for consideration to the president. If the president agrees, that becomes the law. Second important function of the legislature is the budget. The budget is the financial plan of the state for the entire year. This budget is introduced in the Legislative Assembly and it has to be passed in the Legislative Assembly. As far as the budget is concerned, Vidhan Sabha or Legislative Assembly has got the far greater authority than the Vidhan Parishad. This applies to all money bills. In all money bills, the function, the authority of the Vidhan Sabha is higher than the Vidhan Parishad. Vidhan, the budget after getting passed in the Vidhan Sabha will also be sent to the Vidhan Council with the Vidhan Parishad for consideration. The council can suggest the modification. Some council can suggest changes, but it cannot reject any financial bill, and it also cannot keep it pending indefinitely. It has to return all the financial bill within a period of the 14 days. If it is not returned within 14 days, it is assumed that the bill is passed. Third important function is the administrative function. The Legislative Assembly controls the administration of the state. It is an executive body. This executive body remains in place. It functions only as long as it enjoys the confidence of the assembly. That is, the chief minister and council of ministers are responsible to the assembly, and they remain in their position only as long as they enjoy the confidence of the assembly. Next important function is the electoral function. That is, the Legislative Assembly also has got the electoral function. Let's see, where do they elect? They elect three important, they do the electoral duty in three important areas. The first one is, the members of the legislative councils are partly elected by the Legislative Assembly. That means Vidhan Parishad members are partially elected by the Vidhan Sabha members. That is, one third of the MLCs are elected by the MLAs. In Karnataka, we have got a total of 75 MLCs. So 25 MLCs are elected directly from the Vidhan Sabha. That is the Legislative Assembly. Another area where the MLAs cast their vote is for the election of the Rajya Sabha. Certain number of Rajya Sabha MP seats are fixed for each state, and these Rajya Sabha MPs are elected by the MLAs of the state. You may be knowing that presently the nominations are being invited for the Rajya Sabha MPs, and in a short time there will be elections to the certain number of Rajya Sabha seats from different states. In addition to these two bodies, the MLAs also elect the presidents of India. That is, they cast their vote in the presidential election also. For the presidential election, the Lok Sabha MPs, the Rajya Sabha MPs vote, and in addition, the members of the state legislative assembly also vote for the presidential election. Now let's come to the legislative council or Vidhana Parishad. The Vidhana Parishad members are partly elected and they are partly nominated. It will consist of both elected members as well as the nominated, the members. One third of the members of the Vidhana Parishad are elected from the Vidhan Sabha, that is the state legislative assembly. One third of the members are elected from the local bodies, the municipalities and the district. The bodies elect the one third members of the legislative council. Then we have got two more the constituencies. One is what is known as a graduate constituencies, where the graduates from any university, they enroll as voters, and there are certain graduate constituencies. 1/12 of the members of the legislative council are elected from the graduate constituencies, where only graduates vote. Similarly, there are certain number of teachers constituencies, that is the 1/12 of the total number of the seats in the Vidhana Parishad. Here only the teachers vote for electing the members to these members representing these constituencies. The finally, in addition to all these elected bodies, the 1/6 of the members are nominated by the governor. This is with the intention of giving representation to certain important areas in the legislature, such as the people of eminence in literature, sports, the science, arts, social service. These are all the areas which need to be represented in the legislature. For giving proper representation to these areas, the 1/6 of the members are nominated by the governor to the legislative council or Vidhana Parishad. Let's see exactly what are the number of the MLCs. The legislative assembly elects the 1/3 of the members, that is, they elect the 25 members to the Vidhana Parishad. Then the local authorities elect 1/3 of the members to the Vidhana Parishad. That is going to be another 25 members. Then I said 1/12 of the members are elected by the graduates constituency. That comes to 7 members. 1/12 of the members are elected by teachers constituency. That again comes to 7 members. So in all, we have got the 64 elected members to our Vidhana Parishad or Legislative Council. Then we have got the nominated members. That is 1/6 of the total, the strength. That comes to 11 members. This is 64 elected plus 11 nominated. That comes to 75 members. This 75 is the strength of the Vidhana Parishad or Legislative Council at present. For contesting to the Vidhana Parishad, a person should attain the age of 30 years, unlike Vidhana Sabha, where the age was 25 years. Nominate members can participate any discussion. They can contribute their ideas and suggestions, but they do not have the voting rights. The voting is done only by the elected members in the Legislative Council. Our constitution provides that there should be a minimum of 40 members in the legislative, the council. It should not be less than 40. At the same time, the upper limit is that it should not increase more than 1/3 of the total member of the legislative assembly. That is Vidhana Sabha's one strength, 1/3 is the upper limit for Vidhana Parishad, and less, the minimum number is the 40. In our state, we have got 224 the MLAs. So exactly 1/3, that is a 75 is our strength for Vidhana Parishad. Coming to the presiding officer of the Vidhana Parishad, he is known as the chairman, and he presides over the meeting of the legislative council. This chairman is directly elected by the members of the legislative council. He conducts the sittings of the houses of the house, that is the legislative council. Now, after discussing the state legislature, let us come to the state executive. In the state executive, the governor is the topmost the person in the state executive. He is appointed by the President of India based on the recommendation of the Union Council of Ministers. That is a central, the ministry, the Prime Minister and the Union Council of Ministers recommend the person to be appointed as a state governor, and the president appoints the governor. He enjoys a similar position as the president does at the state level with respect to the legislature. Here, the president does what he does with respect to the parliament, a similar duty the governor has got with respect to the state legislature. He is the constitutional head of the state. But as the governor, as the president does at the central level, he also exercises his power on the advice of the Council of Ministers of the state. To become a governor, there are certain eligibilities. One is, naturally, he should be a citizen of India. Minimum age is 35 years for the governor. And this governor should not be a member of the Union Parliament or any state legislature. And the governor of a state can be removed only by the President of India. That is, there is no way to remove a governor except by the President of India. Let's come to the power and functions of the President. One of the areas where the governor's function extends is the state executive. He is the executive head of the state, and he appoints the chief ministers and the council of ministers. He appoints the members of the state public service commission and the high ranking the officials. He also appoints the Council of Ministers on the advice of the Chief Minister. He has got the legislative powers. That means the governor can summon the Vidhana Sabha and Vidhana Parishad, and he also has got the power to dissolve the Vidhana Sabha under exceptional the cases. He enjoys the powers to nominate the members of the council. Any bill has to be signed by the governor to become a law. That means a bill cannot become a law unless without the governor's consent. Just like the president can issue ordinances at the central level, the governor has got a power to issue ordinances at the state level. Ordinance means when there is insufficient time to pass a law, when a certain law is very urgently required, the governor can sign an ordinance that becomes the law, and the law has to be passed in the legislature in the next 6 months. That means when the law is very urgent, that the requirement can be met by the ordinance issued by the governor. Budget cannot be presented without his consent. That is, the before presenting the budget, the governor's consent is to be taken by the chief minister or the finance minister. Coming to the financial powers, the one of the power already we have discussed, the budget cannot be presented without the governor's consent. In addition to that, the members of the state planning commission and the state finance commissions are appointed by the governor. Governor also has got the judicial powers, that is appointments and transfers and postings of the district judges are made by the governor. Like the president, governor also has got the power to pardon or reduce the sentences at the state level. In addition to all these powers, governor also has got the discretionary powers. What we mean by discretionary power is the power which the governor uses as per his best judgment. He has got a freedom of deciding what should be done in a particular situation without the advice of his ministers. This is what we call the discretionary powers. He need not take advice. He can take action based on his judgment of the situation. Those powers are the discretionary, the powers. His discretionary powers are mainly with respect to the following issues. He can recommend to the government. This recommendation need not have the sanction of the state chief minister or the state assembly. He can recommend to the president to dissolve the assembly. If the state is not functioning as per the provisions of the constitution, he has got a power to dissolve. He has a power to recommend to the president to dissolve the state assembly. He also has got a power to recommend to the president to declare a state emergency. He also has got a power to recommend to the president to introduce the president's rule in his or her state. If the president's rule is imposed on a particular the state, the governor in fact takes all the executive powers of the government in that particular state. Now let's come to the chief minister. The chief minister is the executive head of the state. Of course, the governor is the constitutional head, but the real executive powers of the state rest with the chief minister. Chief minister is the head of the council of ministers. Chief minister has got the support of the other ministers, and with their cooperation he runs the state government. To become a chief minister, he has to enjoy the majority in the legislative assembly. That means he should be a leader of the majority in the Vidhan Sabha. If more than half the members of the Vidhan Sabha support a particular person, he can become a chief minister. These chief ministers are, chief minister is appointed by the governor, and once the chief minister is appointed, he makes a list of the council of ministers, and based on this list, the governor will appoint the council of ministers on the advice of the chief minister. Chief minister, in fact, is forming the government with the support of the ministers. All the administrative tasks of the state are carried out by the chief minister based on the decisions of the council of ministers. The chief minister enjoys a term of 5 years or till the dissolution of the assembly. That is, if the assembly is dissolved earlier than 5 years, automatically the fresh election will be there. Until the period of term of 5 years or until the assembly is dissolved, chief ministers remain in position. That is, he remains in position only as long as he enjoys the confidence of the house. At any at any point of time, the more than half the members of the Legislative Assembly lose confidence in him, they can move a no confidence motion, he will lose his position. That is, he remains as the Chief Minister as long as he enjoys the confidence of the House. That means any person, he or she, remains Chief Minister until the person enjoys the majority support of the Vidhan Sabha. Suppose in a certain situation, the Chief Minister resigns. Once the Chief Minister resigns, it is that all the other ministers automatically will not have their position. That means the Chief Minister's resignation results in the resignation of the entire Council of Ministers. Once the Chief Minister goes, the entire Council of Ministers goes. The new Chief Minister will form his Council of Ministers afresh. Coming to the power of the Chief Minister, Chief Minister has got a power to allot portfolios. He can allot the portfolios, for example, the finance, the education, the home, forest, the portfolios he can allot to the ministers based on his choice and judgment. Once he is allotted, he goes to every power to reshuffle periodically. After some time, he wants to change the cabinet, change his council of ministers. He can interchange the portfolios among his ministers. He can drop any minister. He can appoint a new minister. That is, the reshuffling the council of ministers is a prerogative of the Chief Minister. Chief Minister has got every power to include people or exclude people from the state legislature. Suppose he wants to drop a minister, he may ask the minister to resign. If the minister does not remain, he can request the governor to dismiss that particular person from the council of the ministry. It is the Chief Minister who decides the policies and programs of the government in consultation with his cabinet and his council of ministers. The Chief Minister supervises and coordinates the policies of several ministers and departments. When there are a number of ministries, we need a proper coordination. This coordination is achieved by the Chief Minister. The sessions of the assembly are summoned and prorogued by the governor on the advice of the Chief Minister. That means he advises the governor to start, that is, to summon the sessions of Vidhan Sabha and Vidhan Parishad, and also to the end, that is, to prorogue the sessions of Vidhan Sabha and Vidhan Parishad. And in all these matters, the Chief Minister keeps informed the governor of the developments and decisions and policies of the state government. So he keeps the governor always informed about the policies and decisions of the state government. Next, let's come to the Council of Ministers. The Chief Minister selects the Council of Ministers to support him in the administration of the state. Of course, in the Council of the Ministers, there's going to be an inner body known as the Cabinet Ministers, who are the most important, the ministers who attend the cabinet meetings. And then we have got the other ministers. So all the ministers together, they form the Council of Ministers. The Chief Minister has got the discretion to select a group of people and who can assist him to run the government efficiently. Normally, members of the legislature are appointed as ministers, that is, either MLAs or MLCs are selected as the ministers, but there is no such strict condition. Even the non-members can also be nominated as the ministers. That means somebody who is not a member of either Vidhan Sabha or Vidhan Parishad can also become the minister, but there is a condition: he should get elected to one of the houses of the legislature within the 6 months from the date of appointment as minister. That means within the next the 6 months, he should become either an MLA or MLC to continue as the minister. After discussing the state executive, we will come to the next lower level of the administration. We'll discuss the local self-government. It is the vision of our the constitution to bring the powers to the lowest the level. That means the decision making and the implementation power should percolate downwards to the grassroots. With that intention, the local self-governments are formed. That is because from a central authority, it is difficult to reach to the villages from the central government. So we need the local authorities to directly deal with the villages, because ours is a country of vast number of the villages. In fact, people say India lives in its villages. So at the village level, proper planning is the extreme important. So the local self-governments is the with the objectives involving people at the grassroots level in the decision-making process. It is not the decisions are thrust from the top. The grassroots people should be involved in making decisions for the destiny. There may be many problems at the local levels that need to be solved at the local level. For that, we need the decentralization. That is, we need the local self, the government. Coming to the functions of the local self government, one of the local self governance, one of the important issue is to look after the developmental works in its locality. When we say developmental works, it includes the drinking water facilities, healthcare facilities, housing facilities, education, the electricity, sanitation. All those things are needed at the local level. Another important function of the local bodies is to monitor the working of PDS, that is public distribution system, with respect to the all items, the food grains, the kerosene. These are all the part of the public distribution system. This is to be monitored and properly implemented at the local level by the local bodies. The central government and the state government will come with a number of the developmental programs, and these programs are to be properly monitored, properly implemented at the local level by the local bodies. For many of the local, the welfare schemes of the central and state government, there is a need to identify the beneficiaries so that the welfare scheme goes to the right the people. And this identification of beneficiaries is another function of the local bodies. In addition to all these things, it has to plan the welfare schemes for the benefit of the weaker sections of society, such as the scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, women and children, and weaker sections. There is a need for special welfare programs. This is to be planned and coordinated at the local level. Collection of the taxes is another the function of the local bodies. Let's see from where the money comes to the local bodies for implementing its programs. One of the source of money is the rent collected by many public the utilities. For example, the local bodies have got their own buildings, their own playground, their own park. So all this is rented out for collecting the money. That means it collects taxes on its property, on the buildings of the local bodies, on vacant site like parks, maidans, the shops, the markets. These are all constructed by the municipalities and panchayats. They rent it out, and this rent is one source of money for the local bodies. In addition to this rent, it also collects cess. That means local governing bodies collect education cess, the health cess, water cess. These are the taxes on the taxes, what is known as a cess. And these cess goes to the local, the bodies for promoting the health, promoting education, etc. In addition to these two sources, the government also gives a fixed number of, fixed amount of grant to the local bodies, central government as well as the state governments allot the grant. This grant is another source of revenue for the local self-government. At the lowest level of the local, the bodies, we have got the Gram Panchayats. Gram Panchayat is the basic unit of the local self-governance. The rules and regulations of the Gram Panchayat for its composition and formation is done at the state level. So the rules and regulations vary from state to state. In Karnataka, there will be the village panchayat, where further going to be the Gram Panchayat for a population of 5,000 to 7,000 the people. That means for every 5,000 to 7,000 people, there will be a Gram Panchayat. This Gram Panchayat will be elected again directly by the people above the 18 years of age, that is the universal adult franchise. So these, the Gram Panchayat members are elected by the people, and usually one representative is elected for every 400 the voters. There is going to be a reservation after the population. This reservation is for SCST, reservation for the SC and SC as well as the women. Now the one-third members, one-third the post of the elected members as well as the office bearers is the reserved for the women as per the constitution amendments. So that is the about the reservation to the weaker sections. There is going to be the adhyakshas and upadhyakshas for each Gram Panchayat, and the condition is that the Gram Panchayat should meet at least once in 2 months. Every 2 months minimum, the Gram Panchayat should meet. Next higher level is the Taluk Panchayat, which is above the Gram Panchayat. In Taluk Panchayat is also based on the population. In Karnataka, every 1,000 people will have a Taluk Panchayat member. As I said, for every 400 voters, there is going to be a Gram Sabha member. For every 1,000 voters, there is going to be a Taluk Panchayat, the member. In addition to the elected members, 1/5 of the presidents of the Gram Panchayat are chosen by a lot who serve as members of the Taluk Panchayat for 1 year. Here again, there is reservation for SC, for ST, and also for women in the Taluk Panchayat. The Taluk Panchayat will have an elected president and the vice president elected by the representatives. The president presides over the meeting of the Taluk Panchayat. In addition to the president and the members of the Taluk Panchayat, MLAs, MLCs and MPs of the concerned area can also participate, can also attend the meetings of the Taluk Panchayat if they wish. Next, come to the urban local bodies. The urban local body is the equivalent of the local governance at the urban level. Similarly, just like a village, there are problems which are specific to the urban area. For addressing these problems, the urban local bodies are constituted. The urban local bodies are classified into three categories. One is the town municipalities or the municipal councils, that is at the lowest level. Next is the city corporations. And next is Mahanagarapalike, and finally it is a Brihat Mahanagarapalike. These are the different levels of the urban local bodies. Coming to the functions of the urban local bodies, it has got a variety of functions. The first and foremost is the urban planning and town planning is one function of the urban local bodies. Regulating the use of the land and buildings. That means for the construction of the buildings, every person has to take the permission from the urban local bodies. It controls the regulation of the land for different purposes in its area. Planning economical and social development of the area is another function of the urban local bodies. Maintaining the roads and bridges is another function. Water supply maintenance for the domestic as well as industrial and commercial the purposes is another the work of the urban local bodies. In addition, it takes steps to maintain the public health, sanitation and the waste management in its area. The fire services are installed and monitored by the urban local bodies. The protection of the environment and the urban forestry, parks, greenery is again the function of the urban local bodies. Safeguarding the weaker sections of the society is also another the area. Slum development also falls under the duty of urban local bodies. The urban local bodies need to make the poverty alleviation programs for the welfare of the people. It maintains the parks, gardens, and playgrounds in its area. The urban local body also promotes cultural, educational, and aesthetic aspects of the city. The burials and the burial grounds and the crematoriums are again maintained by the urban local bodies. The provision for the cattle ponds and prevention of cruelty to the animals is also a work of the urban local bodies. There is a need to register the birth and death of every person. This registration of birth and death is managed by the urban local bodies. For the safety and convenience of the people, the urban local bodies maintain the street lighting, the parking lots for vehicles and bus stops. It also maintains the hygienic condition of the slaughterhouses operating in the city. For doing all this, the work, let's see, where does money come from? What are the financial sources of the urban local bodies? Here again, the first is the taxes it collects for its properties. The properties of the urban local bodies will include the shops, the vacant sites, the business establishments. It collects taxes from all these bodies. It collects the rent on the property, such as the markets, such as the shopping complexes, buildings, community hall, the town hall, etc. There is another source. The cess, the educational cess, health cess are all the money which goes to the urban local bodies for the specific purposes. In addition to all these things, it also receives a grant from the central and state government for its working. Coming to the town municipalities, if the town or a small city will have a town municipality, usually a population between 20,000 and 15,000 is known as a town, and it will have the municipal corporation. When the area of the population becomes more than 50,000 and up to 3 lakhs, that becomes a city and it will have a city corporation. So town is slightly smaller and city is bigger compared to the town. The town municipality and city corporation are both the self-governing bodies perform the functions which we discussed earlier. Coming to the city corporations, where the population is more than 2 lakhs, we have got Mahanagarapalike. The population in a Mahanagarapalike may extend up to 1 crore. Here, the members of the Mahanagarapalike are directly elected by the voters, and these elected members are known as the corporators. They are members of the Mahanagarapalike. Usually, the number of members in a Mahanagarapalike lies between the 30 and 100. That is the minimum, 100 is the maximum members of the Mahanagarapalike. The term of the members of the Mahanagarapalike is 5 years, and it can be extended by the state government for a period of 1 year. Then we have got Bangalore, which is very huge, which is much bigger than usual Mahanagarapalike. Then that is called Brihat Bengaluru Mahanagarapalike. So that is the administrating such a huge, such a big area is a very complex the task. So this administrative body for Bangalore is known as the Greater Bangalore Metropolitan Area, that is Brihat Bengaluru Mahanagarapalike. This BBMP is run by a city council. Here again, there will be corporators, and each corporator will represent a ward, and these corporators will work. They will have a term of 5 years. That's about the state executive. Next, let's go to discuss certain important the constitutional functionaries. One of the most important the constitutional body of a country is the election commission. Without free and fair election, there is no democracy. So the free and fair election is the cornerstone of the democratic system. For that, we need an efficient election commission which works without fear, without favor, impartially. That is, in a democracy, the election commission enjoys a very, very important position. That is, the independence of the election commission is very essential for the survival of the democracy. In India, we have got the election commission, where there is a chief election commissioner and also 2 election commissioners, that is 1 chief election commissioners and below him 2 election commissioners. So these election commissions are appointed by the president of India, and once the election commissioner is appointed, he cannot be removed. He or she cannot be removed by any administrative process except by the impeachment by the parliament. That is, removing an election commissioner should follow the same procedure of removing a Supreme Court judge. Only an impeachment in the parliament can remove an election commissioner. That is, the election commissioner holds utmost the security with respect to his position. This is done to give the election commissioner all the authority to deal with the political parties and to act in a free and fair manner without showing any partiality to any of the parties. Coming to the functions of the election commission, one of the major functions is the preparation of the electoral rolls. We have got crores and crores of voters, enumerating and making a list of these crores of voters, and then updating and modifying the roll is a big task. That means whoever attains the age of 18 years should be included in the electoral roll. Of anybody who dies, his name has to be deleted from the electoral roll. When a person moves from one place to another place, his name is to be deleted from the roll of one place and included in the roll of other places. These are all the preparation and the revision of the electoral rolls. This is a huge process which is undertaken by the election commission. Then election commission determines the population for the purpose of the elections. That means to decide to demarcate the constituencies for the assembly and parliamentary election. It is to know the population, and this population, based on this population, election commission can demarcate the area for the constituencies. Election commission also conducts the election of the president and also the vice president of India. In addition to the MPs and MLAs election, the presidents and vice presidents elections are also done by the election commissioner. The election commissioner also has got superintendence for directing the conduct of all elections of parliament and the state legislature. That means that all the MPs and MLAs elections are controlled by the election, the commission. The election commission has got authority for deciding the qualifications for the members of the parliament. It has got power to modify it. The election commission can also decide the composition of the state, the legislatures. Election commission takes decisions relating to the reservation of the seats for the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. We know there are certain reserved constituencies in our country where only SC or ST candidates can contest. So the demarcating or identifying or changing these constituencies is the task of the election commission. One of the most important work of the election commission is to provide a level playing ground for all political parties. It has to ensure that there is an equal chance for participating in election process to all political parties. It should not favor or disfavor any of the political parties. There should be a free level playing ground where all the political parties can put forth the manifestos. They can contest for the votes of the people. Once the elections are announced, the model code of conduct comes into picture. What political parties can do or what they can't do, what government can do, what government can't do, is based on a model code of conduct during the period of election. That means once the date for election is announced, right from that moment, the restrictions on the government, restrictions of the ministers, restrictions on public, the authorities, of what can be done, what cannot be done. This is what was a model code of conduct. The enforcing this model code of conduct is the responsibility or the function of the election commission. So that is about the election commission. Another important constitutional body is the Union Public Service Commission, the UPSC. This UPSC has got the specific function of recruitment of the civil services at the union level. That means all the government, the posts, including the topmost, the post, are done by the UPSC through competitive exams and through the proper the procedures. That means the administrative bodies, including the administrative services and also the lower the level jobs, all these are done by the UPSC based on its procedure. So the number of members of the UPSC are determined by the president. He decides the members of the Union Public Service Commission. Usually the half of the members of the UPSC are the people having the administrative experience, while the other half come from the liberal positions, like liberal professions, like the law, academics, like that. Coming to the functions of the UPSC, it has got a function to conduct the examinations for the appointment to the various posts of the central government. That means it conducts examinations, it fixes the procedures for selecting the people for different posts. Based on that, people are selected by the UPSC. and it advises any matter which is referred to them by the president with respect to the appointment, with respect to the qualifications for different the jobs. So here, to exercise the function, the additional functions may be provided by the Act of the Parliament regarding the services of the Union and also with respect to the service of the local authority constituted by law. We have the central body for the appointing the central, the officials, the UPSC. Similarly, we have a state body for appointing the members at the state level, that is the State Public Service Commission, that is the KPSC. So whatever the function we discussed at the union level for the UPSC is done at the state level by the KPSC, that is State Public Service Commission, which makes the appointment with respect to the various the positions of the state. Well, friends, so we started our discussion today with the state government. That means we discussed the different the aspects which forming the structure of the state government. First, we discussed the state legislature, which consists of Vidhan Sabha and Vidhan Parishad. Vidhan Sabha are the people who are directly elected by the people. Vidhan Sabha is a specialized body where the 1/3 members are elected by the Vidhan Sabha, and then 1/3 members are elected by the local bodies, and then we have got 1/12 from the graduate constituency, 1/12 from the teachers constituency, and 1/6 of the nominated members. Then we went on to discuss the powers and functions of the Vidhan Sabha and Vidhan Parishad. We also discussed about the presiding officers of the Vidhan Sabha and Vidhan Parishad. That's what is about the legislature. Then we went on to discuss the state executive. We discussed the roles and functions of the governor, which is on parallel lines to the president of India, but with respect to the states only. Then we discussed the real executive head of the state, who is the chief minister of the state, who forms the frames the policies and the runs the administration based on the support from the council of the ministers. Then we have seen that there is a need for the local self-governance, that is the power should flow to the grassroots. For this, we have got the gram panchayats, we have got taluk panchayats, then we have got the urban local bodies, the city municipalities, city corporations, the BBMP. All these are the effort to bring the power, the administration, to the grassroots. Then we have got certain important the legislative bodies. So these constitutional bodies have a very important place in our the government as per the constitution. One of the bodies is the election commission, which is entrusted with the role of conducting free and fair elections. It conducts the elections for the central the government, that is for the MPs. It conducts election for the MLAs of the states, and also it conducts the elections of the president and vice president. And finally, we have seen the duties of the Public Service Commission. At the union level, it makes appointments for the central government. At the state level, it makes appointment for the state government. That was about the state, the government. Thank you.